Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. US President Donald Trump has again made a controversial statement, and this time it concerns the Kashmir conflict. Currently, the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Mr. Imran Khan, is on a visit to the United States, and during his interaction with Donald Trump, the US President has said that he would love to be a mediator on the Kashmir conflict. And this is not the only controversial statement that he has made. He has also said that Prime Minister Modi had made a similar request when the two leaders met a couple of weeks back at the G20 summit, which was held in Osaka, Japan. So the offer made by Donald Trump to act as a mediator over the Kashmir conflict and his claim that Indian Prime Minister had requested for his mediation has triggered a massive controversy in India. So in order to understand why these statements are controversial, we need to look at the response that has been issued by the government of India and as well as the arguments that have been raised by the opposition parties in India. See, with regard to the Kashmir conflict, India has a long-standing position that it will not accept any third-party mediation. Because India considers the Kashmir conflict to be a bilateral issue between India and Pakistan. So since many decades, India has rejected any form of third-party mediation over the Kashmir conflict, and it has always said that the conflict should be resolved through peaceful bilateral negotiations only between India and Pakistan. And this policy of India is not just an opinion of the Indian government. Instead, it is a commitment on both the countries that has been enshrined in the Shimla Agreement of 1972, and the same commitment has been reiterated in the Lahore Declaration of 1999. So in this context, let us look at the key details of the Shimla Agreement and the Lahore Declaration, which can be very important for mains. The Shimla Agreement was signed between India and Pakistan in 1972, following the liberation of Bangladesh War of 1971. On one hand, the Shimla Agreement was a peace treaty between the two countries to deal with the consequences of the 1971 war. Through this agreement, both the countries agreed to withdraw the troops back to the international border, and under the same agreement, both the countries agreed to exchange their POWs or prisoners of war. This is very significant because during the 1971 war, India had captured close to 1 lakh POWs from Pakistan. And it also laid the foundation for good friendly relations between India and Pakistan. Through the Shimla Agreement, a comprehensive blueprint was drawn out which committed both the countries to abide by the principles that are enshrined in the UN Charter. Both the countries were committed to promote peace, friendship and cooperation by giving up conflict and confrontation. So through this agreement, a set of guiding principles were worked out to define India's relations with Pakistan, and it emphasized on key points such as respect for each other's territorial integrity and sovereignty, non-interference in each other's internal affairs, respect for each other's unity, political independence. It also provided for respecting each other's sovereign equality. This means that both India and Pakistan, they are bound to treat each other as equals. And it also committed both the countries to give up any hostile propaganda against each other. So based on these key points, a few principles were laid out to define India's relations with Pakistan. And one of the most important principles is the mutual commitment of both the countries to promote a peaceful resolution of all outstanding issues through direct bilateral approaches. So as you can see, the agreement binds both the countries to resolve any outstanding issue only through peaceful negotiations which are carried out in the bilateral format. So clearly, there is no scope for any third-party mediation. the agreement does not provide for the involvement of any third party in resolving outstanding issues between India and Pakistan. So it is this principle of the Shimla Agreement that India has adopted as a long-standing policy over the Kashmir conflict. Since many decades, India has said that it will not allow any third-party mediation because both the countries are committed under the Shimla Agreement to resolve all issues through peaceful bilateral negotiations. And the Shimla Agreement was also looking to promote people-to-people relations. It was focused on improving trade, connectivity and cultural relations, and it also bound both the countries to treat the line of control as inviolable. This is one of the most important confidence-building measures between India and Pakistan, which is the key to establishing durable peace between the two countries. So till date, India has faithfully observed the principles and the commitments of the Shimla Agreement, whereas Pakistan has regularly flouted these commitments. Next, we have the Lahore Declaration, which was signed in 1999. It was a historic agreement which was signed between Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee and the then Prime Minister of Pakistan, Mr. Nawaz Sharif. This declaration was signed during the Lahore summit, which took place in the aftermath of the nuclear tests. During this period, tensions were extremely high between India and Pakistan because both the countries had tested their nuclear weapons in 1998. So, in order to reduce these tensions, a few steps were taken by both the governments, which included the launch of a bus service between India and Pakistan. So, to inaugurate the bus service, Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif invited Prime Minister Vajpayee, and this is how the historic Lahore summit took place in 1999. At the end of the summit, a declaration was signed, which has come to be known as the Lahore Declaration. This agreement is also focused on promoting peace and stability between the two countries and protecting the vital interests of the people of both the countries. So, in order to provide for peace, progress and prosperity in the region, both the countries had to address the new security environment which had come up in the South Asia region because of the added nuclear dimension. Now that both the countries possessed nuclear weapons, it could have easily triggered an arms race between both the countries. It could even result in an accidental or unauthorized use of nuclear weapons against each other. So, in order to prevent these possibilities, both the countries committed to each other to realize the objective of universal nuclear disarmament and non-proliferation. They even implemented a number of steps in order to prevent the accidental or unauthorized use of nuclear weapons. And both the countries reiterated their commitment to the principles of the UN Charter. They were determined to promote the cause of peaceful coexistence, and they reiterated the need to implement the Shimla Agreement of 1972 in letter and spirit. So it is on the basis of these two agreements that the statements made by Donald Trump have become highly controversial. Now let's take up the next article. ISRO has successfully launched the Chandrayaan 2 mission with a smooth liftoff of the GSLV Mach 3 rocket. This is just the first step in the complicated mission. Right now, the GSLV Mach 3 rocket has placed the lunar module in the geosynchronous transfer orbit. And over the next few weeks, ISRO will be carrying out a number of orbit-raising maneuvers in order to place the lunar module into the lunar orbit. And once the Chandrayaan 2 mission is placed in the lunar orbit, it will be slowly made to descend, and the lunar orbiter will continue to orbit the moon for around 1 year, and during this period, it will map and study the surface of the moon. And once the orbiter is placed in the designated orbit, the lander, that is Vikram, will detach itself and it will attempt to make a soft landing at the south pole of the moon. This landing phase of Vikram is expected to be the most complicated phase of the mission, and it is expected to take place on the 7th of September 2019. If ISRO succeeds in making a soft landing, then it will make India the fourth country after China, Russia and the United States to have made a successful soft landing on the lunar surface. And once Vikram makes a soft landing, the rover, that is Pragyan, will step out and it will explore the lunar surface by collecting samples in order to study the mineral composition of the lunar surface. So the successful launch of the mission is just the first step in a complicated mission, but it definitely marks a major leap for ISRO, because just last week it suffered a major setback due to a technical glitch and the launch of Chandrayaan 2 had to be postponed. But within a week, ISRO has bounced back with flying colors and it managed to fix the technical glitch and it successfully launched the Chandrayaan 2 mission. So for further details about the mission, you can watch our detailed analysis on the 13th of July and the 16th of July. Next, we have a related article on page number 9, which talks about the significance of the year 2019 as far as lunar exploration is concerned. The article says that the month of July 2019 marks the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 mission of the United States, and in July 1969, NASA became the first space agency to land humans on the lunar surface. So this month marks the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 mission, and India's Chandrayaan 2 mission is the third lunar exploration attempt for 2019. Because earlier this year, China succeeded in achieving a soft landing on the lunar surface through its Chang'e 4 mission. With this, China became the first country to land on the far side of the moon or the dark side of the moon. Then we had a failed attempt by Israel wherein it tried to make a soft landing of its Bereshit spacecraft. But this mission of Israel failed because the engines malfunctioned during the descent phase and the Bereshit spacecraft crashed into the lunar surface. And now we have India with its Chandrayaan 2 mission, which has been successfully launched and it is all set to make a landing on the 7th of September 2019. And we can see a renewed global interest in launching lunar exploratory missions. And China has already announced the Chang'e 5 spacecraft, which will be launched in December 2019. And it is designed to collect the lunar samples and bring them back to Earth. So Chang'e 5 is a very ambitious upcoming mission for China. And the NASA of United States has also announced an initiative for 2024. To send humans back to the moon. So this clearly shows the renewed global interest in exploring the moon, and it also highlights the ongoing space race amongst the major spacefaring nations of the world. And it is not just US and China that have planned up ambitious lunar missions, but India has already begun the groundwork for a Chandrayaan 3 mission in joint collaboration with the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency. ISRO has already begun negotiations with its Japanese counterpart, the JAXA, for a joint mission to the moon in 2024. According to reports, the proposed Chandrayaan 3 mission would be quite similar to the Chang'e 5 mission of China. It will be designed to collect soil and rock samples from the lunar surface and bring it back to Earth. So this is definitely an ambitious mission that ISRO is looking to take up with JAXA, and negotiations have already begun over the last couple of years. Next, we have an editorial on page number 10, which is related to the same topic, and it highlights the challenges for the Chandrayaan 2 mission. First, the editorial credits the ISRO for a successful launch and calls it a huge achievement, because this is the first operational flight of the GSLV Mach 3 that has been developed indigenously. The GSLV Mach 3 is a medium to heavy lift rocket which can lift around 4 tons of payload and place it in the geosynchronous transfer orbit. Next, it talks about the two complicated phases in the Chandrayaan 2 mission. One would be the orbit raising maneuvers that are needed to transfer the Chandrayaan 2 from the Earth's orbit to the lunar orbit. And the second most complicated phase would definitely be the descent phase of Vikram. Back in 2008, ISRO had crash landed the Moon Impact Probe, which was a part of the Chandrayaan 1 mission. But in comparison to a crash landing, achieving a soft landing would be extremely complex because a series of braking mechanisms will have to work effectively in order to drastically reduce the velocity of Vikram. So if ISRO succeeds in soft landing Vikram, it will not just be a success for India, but it will also be a major leap for lunar studies. Because back in 2008, the Moon Impact Probe was responsible for the detection of water molecules on the lunar surface by working along with the Moon Mineralogy Mapper, which was developed by NASA as one of the payloads for the Chandrayaan 1 mission. So if Vikram manages to make a soft landing, then the roving experiments of Pragyan will definitely add a lot of scientific value to understand the composition of the lunar surface. And the lunar orbiter of the Chandrayaan 2 mission is carrying a very high resolution camera known as the terrain mapping camera. Such a camera was carried by the Chandrayaan 1 mission as well. It managed to develop a three-dimensional map with a high resolution of 5 kilometers. But this time around, the Chandrayaan 2 mission is carrying a terrain mapping camera of an even higher resolution in order to produce a detailed 3D map of the moon. And ISRO will also make use of the Chandrayaan 2 mission to study the vertical temperature gradient and thermal conductivity of the lunar surface, and it will also study lunar seismicity for the first time. So these studies and technologies are expected to lay the groundwork for the future of deep space missions for ISRO. Now let's take up the next article. Odisha has renewed its efforts to revive the gharial population. Gharial is a type of freshwater crocodile and it is listed as critically endangered on the IUCN Red List. So as a part of the revival effort, the State Forest Department has brought 5 gharials from the Nandankanan Zoological Park in the state and it has introduced them in their natural habitat in the Satkosia Gorge of the Mahanadi River. Kindly make a note of this. The Satkosia Gorge of the Mahanadi River marks the southernmost limit of gharial's home range in India. This means that this is the southernmost point at which gharials can be found in India. This is their natural range. If you look at their historical range, they were present across the Indian subcontinent in the Indus River, in the Ganga River, the Brahmaputra, and as well as the Mahanadi River. But today, their range has been restricted to around 14 locations between Nepal and India. So you can find the gharials in few parts of Nepal, Bihar, UP, Madhya Pradesh, even in few parts of Jharkhand and West Bengal. But the southernmost point is the Satkosia Gorge of the Mahanadi River. Gharials can also be found in few locations in the northeast of India and as well as in few locations in Bangladesh. So due to their fast depleting numbers, they have been listed as critically endangered by the IUCN. And this revival effort of the Odisha government is an example for in-situ conservation. In-situ conservation is a type of conservation wherein the species is protected and conserved within its natural habitat. So in this case, 5 gharials have been brought in from the Nandankanan Zoological Park and they have been fitted with radio transmitters and they have been released in their natural habitat. So such a type of conservation is known as in-situ conservation or on-site conservation. The opposite of in-situ conservation is ex-situ conservation. That is when you are conserving a species outside of its natural habitat. So for example, when you bring an animal into a zoological park or when you bring a plant into a botanical garden, then this can be considered as an example for ex situ conservation or off-site conservation. And also please note down that Odisha is the only state in India which has all the three species of crocodiles that are found in the country. It has the gharial, the mugger and the saltwater crocodile. So since 1975 itself, Odisha has begun a crocodile species conservation program and it has established separate rearing centers at Thikarpada for gharials, at Ramtirtha for muggers and at Bitterkanika for saltwater crocodiles. So kindly note this down. This can be very important for prelims. Now let's take up another editorial from page number 10. The editorial deals with the proposed next examination under the National Medical Commission Bill. If you remember, we had discussed the provisions of the National Medical Commission Bill on the 18th of July. So this bill has been introduced in the Parliament and it proposes to replace the Medical Council Act of 1956. And it will also provide for the establishment of the National Medical Commission, which will replace the Medical Council of India. So through this, the government of India is looking to reform the medical education sector in the country, and the National Medical Commission will have complete regulatory powers over medical education. One of the most important provisions in the bill is the proposal to conduct a unified exit test for MBBS course. This unified exit test has been named as the National Exit Test, or NEXT for short, and it has been designed to serve multiple objectives. The scores of the next examination can be used for licensing MBBS graduates, and this will help them to practice medicine. The scores can also be used for entry into postgraduate courses. It can also be used to screen foreign medical students. So such a unified exit test is definitely a much needed reform in order to simplify the process of examination. It will definitely reduce the time and efforts that are required on the part of the students, and it will bring simplicity and standardization with regard to examinations. In this context, we can recollect that a few years back, the government had introduced a unified entry test known as NEET. NEET stands for National Eligibility Cum Entrance Test. This is to seek entrance into undergraduate courses. So on similar lines, the government is proposing a unified exit test at the end of the MBBS course. But the NEET examination had already run into a major controversy because of the opposition from various state governments and as well as from the Indian Medical Association. The state governments had said that a national level unified examination will violate the principle of federalism. And since a few elite colleges had been exempted from the NEET examination, it had generated a lot of opposition from the medical community as well. For example, until now, institutes of higher excellence such as AIIMS, JIPMER, etc., they have been exempted from the NEET examination. But the bill which is being brought in by the government will take away this exemption, and even institutes of higher excellence will be covered under the National Unified Test. So this is definitely a step in the right direction because it does not give any exemptions, and it will help in countering the resentment amongst the medical community and deal with the charges of elitism. And another important feature of the National Medical Commission Bill is that it takes away the previous proposal of introducing a bridge course for Ayush practitioners to make a lateral entry into allopathic medicine. This was a controversial provision which was included in the 2017 bill of the National Medical Commission, but this provision has been removed and it has been amended in the newly introduced bill. So the editorial says that the proposed bill is taking a number of steps in the right direction in order to reform medical education in India. But the problem is the opposition that is being faced by the state governments and as well as by the Indian Medical Association. Similar opposition has already been expressed about the national exit test as well. So the editorial is asking the government of India to build consensus and ensure that the national exit test doesn't meet with the same fate as that of the NEET examination. Because the NEET examination had run into a number of controversies, and this is something that the national exit test should be avoiding. Next, we have a column on the editorial page which deals with the topic of NRC and the functioning of foreigner tribunals in the state of Assam. But we have covered this topic in detail on the 17th of July and the 20th of July. So you can refer to these videos and go through some of the key points. Next, we also have a column in the op-ed page which deals with the recent amendments to the RTI Act that are designed to dilute the powers and the functioning of the information commissions. This topic has been discussed in detail in yesterday's analysis. So kindly go back and watch the video, and that should be more than sufficient for this topic. Now let us take up the practice questions for today. Which of the following statements are correct? Gharials can be found in both freshwater and saltwater habitats. It once inhabited all the major river systems of the world, but today it has been restricted to India and Nepal. Both the statements are wrong, because gharials can be found only in freshwater habitats. They cannot be found in saltwater habitats. And with regard to the second statement, gharials are native to the northern part of the Indian subcontinent. Historically, they were found in all the major river systems of the northern Indian subcontinent. They were not found across the world. So that's the reason why the second statement is wrong. So option D is the correct answer. Now let's take up the second question. Which of the following agreements was signed between India and Pakistan to bring an end to a conflict? The correct answer is option B, 1 and 2 only. Because the Shimla Agreement was signed to end the 1971 war or the liberation of Bangladesh war, and the Tashkent Declaration was signed to end the 1965 conflict. Now let's take up the third question. In the context of the Indian Parliament, the zero hour is best described as a time allocated to MPs to raise matters of public importance that need immediate attention. Option C is the correct answer. Now let's take up a map-based question. The Mahanadi River flows through which of the following states? The correct answer is option B, 1 and 2 only. Please look at the map. The Mahanadi River flows through Chhattisgarh and Odisha. So option B is the correct answer. Now let's take up a question from the 2017 prelims paper. Which of the following are envisaged by the right against exploitation in the Constitution of India? In the Indian Constitution, right against exploitation is covered under Article 23 and 24. So according to these two articles, the fundamental right against exploitation covers prohibition of traffic in human beings and forced labor, and it also covers prohibition of employment of children in factories and mines. So option C is the correct answer. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains-based questions. The first question, US President Trump has recently offered to mediate in the Kashmir conflict, and it presents an opportunity to resolve the long-standing issue between India and Pakistan. Critically evaluate the given statement. The second question, discuss the challenges that lie ahead for the Chandrayaan 2 mission following its successful launch. So please try and write an answer to these questions and post them in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.